Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 9th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which we are conducting in a hybrid format this week. We have apologies from Mark Ruskell, MSP. At agenda item 1, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Item 4 is consideration of the evidence heard this morning, and item 5 is consideration of our work programme. Do we agree to take those items in private? That is agreed. Items 4 and 5 will be taken in private. Our next item is an evidence session on the transfer of operations of ScotRail. Last week, the committee heard from rail industry stakeholders in relation to the transfer. And this morning, I'm pleased to welcome Jenny Gilruth, MSP, Minister for Transport. Good morning, Minister. I also welcome officials joining us from the Scottish Government and other bodies, Jan Spy, Solicitor, Scottish Government, and from Transport Scotland, Bill Reeve, Rail Director, Alan Wardlaw, Franchise Manager, Service Quality and Passenger Satisfaction, and Sarah Aitken, Commercial Programme Manager. Sarah Aitken and Alan Wardlaw join us remotely. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here at committee this morning. Minister, we've allocated around 70 minutes for this session, just so you know what the timing parameters are. And I understand you would like to begin by providing a brief opening statement. So over to you.
Convener. Almost exactly a year ago, on the 17th of March 2021, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, Michael Matheson, advised Parliament that at the conclusion of the current franchise, ScotRail services would be provided within the public sector by the operator of last resort, an arm's-length company owned and controlled by the Scottish Government. The current franchising system was clearly no longer fit for purpose. Now, at that time, there was considerable uncertainty arising from the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic and continuing delays to the publication of the UK Government's White Paper on Rail Reform. A detailed assessment of the options available for ScotRail was undertaken, and it was decided that it would not be appropriate to award another franchise agreement to any party at this time. In the circumstances, our duty to provide or secure ScotRail services through the OLR under Section 30 of the Railways 1993 Act will be engaged when the current franchise agreement ends on the 31st of March this year. Now, as committee members will know, bringing train operators into public sector under government control through Section 30 OLR arrangements is not something that's new. Three train operating companies in England and one in Wales are now in the public sector under government control. A considerable amount of work has taken place since that announcement, and members will be aware that I recently provided an update to Parliament confirming the transition of ScotRail into Scottish Government control will take place on the 1st of April, which is just 17 days from now. So how have we prepared for that transition? Following detailed analysis and consideration, we've adopted a holding company model for the Scottish Government-owned, public sector-operated, operator of last resort arrangements. Now, under this model, a government-owned holding company, Scottish Rail Holdings Limited, will oversee and manage on behalf of ministers the delivery of services by its wholly owned subsidiary, which is ScotRail Trains Limited. It is our view that this is the most robust and sustainable model, compatible with current UK rail legislation, which of course we have no powers to change, and it strikes a balance between the ability of experienced rail professionals to make operational decisions, but also to give that overall accountability to Scottish ministers. Late last year, we announced key fixed-term appointments for Scottish Rail Holdings Limited, so Chris Gibb as the Chief Executive Officer and David Lowry as Finance Director. In addition, arrangements for the formal transfer of ScotRail staff from Abellio ScotRail Limited to ScotRail Trains Limited continues at pace, and engagement with staff and trade unions began in early January. I've also personally met with the trade unions both collectively and individually over recent weeks, and I will work collaboratively with them to ensure the long-term sustainability of rail operations in Scotland. Staff will transfer on their terms and conditions on the 1st of April. They will benefit from public sector pay policy, and we have committed to ensuring that any pay deals which were previously agreed to for 22-23 will be honoured. Over the coming days, the transition team will remain focused on finalising governance and other arrangements for the transition to OLR to ensure that transition is as smooth as possible for passengers and for staff. In relation to governance, we're finalising the chief executive of SRH being designated as the accountable officer. There will be an interim arrangement where the Transport Scotland accountable officer will remain as AO for SRH until an order under Section 483 of the Companies Act 2006 is approved by Parliament. But the 1st of April marks a new beginning for ScotRail, but it also gives us an opportunity to deliver passenger services which are efficient, sustainable, safe, fit for the future, and also which reflect the changing world that we live in. This is a chance to give people across the country to help us shape our vision for the new ScotRail, I think, additionally. And it's clear that we have to adapt to align with changing travel patterns and consider the affordability of railway as we recover from the pandemic. And importantly, we need to make sure that passengers and staff are safe and they feel safe using our stations and our trains. And all of this needs to take place while we're working towards delivering our ambitious target to decarbonise rail passenger services by 2035. So against that backdrop, and I want to ensure that people the length and breadth of Scotland have a chance to have their say on what the new future of ScotRail should look like. Convener, as I outlined in my statement to Parliament a few weeks ago now, there is no doubt that the future of rail services is changing, and we have two particular challenges, I think, to address. One is the future of ScotRail post the 1st of April, and another is the matter of women's safety on public transport. And I note some of the oral evidence the committee took from Transport Focus last week and their research, which found that 85% of women and girls think about their safety while planning or making a journey on public transport. And British Transport figures, of course, on sexual harassment on public transport in London have also shown a 61% increase since before the pandemic began. So as members will know, there are two distinct offers here from me as Minister as we take ScotRail into public ownership. The first is that national conversation on what our railway should look like from April the 1st and how it should best meet passenger need. And the second is that broader look at women's safety on rail and across our public transport network. We'll be launching a consultation on women's safety, spanning all modes of public transport. Plans are currently being developed and officials have started engagement with Engender on this, and we will look to engage other women's organisations to begin that focused engagement. That will look specifically at improving women's experience and safety across public transport. Officials have also started meeting with key groups such as the Safer Transport Strategic Group, which is led by the British Transport Police, which brings together a range of public transport providers to give safer travel across public transport. And I'm to meet with British Transport Police shortly on this, recognising their own campaign on sexual harassment, which started earlier this year. Committee members will also recall that I announced we would be taking forward a national conversation on rail. That will be an opportunity for staff, passengers, communities, trade unions and MSPs who share in our ambition to make Scotland's railway attractive and accessible for all to help shape that vision for ScotRail. And officials are developing the scope and remit for that national conversation currently, and more information will be announced in the coming weeks. Substantial public engagement will begin later this spring following the local government elections, but I'm particularly keen to engage our trade unions in this work, recognising the vital role that they play in ensuring public ownership of our railways works. Finally, Convener, I want to conclude with an invitation to committee members here today to play their part in shaping that national conversation. Officials and I will be happy to take any questions that members may have, but I also think it worth saying that if members have suggestions, I'm keen to hear those too. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. We now move on to questions. The first question I have relates to improvements we might be seeing as a result of the reorganisation of ScotRail. Last week, as you said, this committee took evidence from various stakeholders, but we didn't hear about any improvements that the change of ownership might deliver. We know that the ownership will change, but based on what the committee heard last week, there will be fare increases, service cuts, staffing cuts, no plans for new rolling stock, and potential closures to ticket offices. So the question I have is, what will be improved as a result of the change of ownership?
Thank you, Convener. I think a number of things will improve when ScotRail moves into public ownership. First of all, we have to have a railway which best meets the needs of customers. And you highlighted a number of challenges which were at my doorstep when I was first appointed. And that was why I was very keen through the statement to reshape some of the narrative around about this. So the first thing I think we need to address, what I need to address as Minister, is the relationship with our trade unions in terms of industrial relations. I've spent a lot of time over the past few weeks meeting with the railway unions and listening to their needs. And I think it's hugely important that public ownership of our railways takes the trade unions with us, and I appreciate we might come to more questions on this later in the committee session today. The second thing you'd spoke to is around about service cuts. Now, you will appreciate and understand, and we may come to this later on the ScotRail timetable, there were reductions to timetabling made. That reflected passenger demand. And the thing that we can't account for as we move forward, what we're trying to account for, is how patronage will be impacted by the pandemic as it plays out. So we know at this moment in time, for example, that weekends are busier 11 weekdays. And therefore, that's changed the way in which ScotRail has operated its timetable as a result. It's reflected passenger demand. Now, we want people, more people, to come back to our railways, and I want to support that, absolutely. So we'll need to look at that in due course, and that is something that ScotRail is absolutely committed to doing. You mentioned some of the issues around about ticket office closure proposals, and you will also be aware that some of those proposals have been looked at again, and increases have been made to ticket office opening hours, for example, and some of the stations are now not to close. I have not yet made a final decision on that. I want to speak to the trade unions about that. They have some pretty strong views on this, as you will understand, and I'm very alive to some of the challenges here around about accessibility and women's safety additionally. But I think it is worth pointing out that there hasn't been a ticket office consultation for over 30 years, and the way that folk use our railways has changed in the last 30 years. People buy their tickets online now, people are more likely to use tickets at train stations, for example, but that should not discount from this wider debate, I suppose, that we're having around about ticket offices and their place in a modern railway network. But fundamentally, I think our railway in public ownership has to best meet passenger need. We need to be more responsive as a government, and public ownership will allow us to do that. I don't know if Bill wants to come in on any of the other kind of points that were raised by the convener.
No, Minister, I think you covered most of what we wanted to do. I suppose the other thing to say is that we're continuing, of course, with the programme of decarbonisation, and I think you mentioned specifically rolling stock. We are developing our plans for the procurement of new electric and battery electric rolling stock, subject to appropriate investment scrutiny, but that work is underway at the moment.
Thank you very much. Minister, I'm not hearing about specific improvements that will be delivered. I understand, you know, the ambition to have a rail service that meets the needs of the people of Scotland. That's a great ambition, but I'm not hearing about specific improvements. However, other members will want to explore this issue. The other question I had was, what other options, apart from nationalisation, did the Scottish Government look at? And what advice and alternative options were presented to the Scottish Government apart from nationalisation, and would the Minister be agreeable to share with the committee the advice given to the Scottish Government on those different options?
So the advice that would have been given to the Cabinet Secretary predates my time in office. I may bring in officials on this. I am not averse to sharing that information with the committee personally, but in terms of the advice that would have been considered at the time, it would have been last year in the run-up to...
So all of the consideration was done with reference to the requirements of the UK Railways Act, and that required us to consider what alternatives to recognising... So the first decision was that the Abellio franchise contract would come to an end on the 31st of March this year, and that was a contractual option which ministers chose to make. That then required an analysis of the other options, which included... Firstly, the possibility of another procurement, franchise procurement competition under the current franchise franchising legislation. There is a widespread acceptance across Britain that franchising has had some problems, or has perhaps come to the end of its time, and that's why the UK government, in its recent Rail Review publication, recommended a change to that approach. The other problem is that it would have been almost impossible for folk bidding for the franchise to know what future demand and patronage is, given the uncertainty caused by the pandemic. So for a variety of reasons, the decision not to proceed with the franchising competition at this time was taken. That then left us with the two options of a direct award to an operator, and on occasions the UK government has done that to the incumbent franchisee, or to proceed under Section 30 of the Railways Act, and I'm looking to Jan just in case I get any of these numbers or references wrong, but to Section 30 of the Railways Act under the provisions known as the Operator of Last Resort provisions. Now, those are the provisions that have already been enacted now three times, or three of those the UK government has, Northern, Southeastern, and in City East Coast. The Welsh Government has brought its own franchise in-house in the same manner. And in this case, our ministers elected and received the advice to proceed with that Section 30 option. And that decision was taken on the 21st of March last year, since when we have been working to mobilise for the 1st of April.
Thank you for that. Minister, final brief question. What will be the total estimated costs for the reorganisation?
The estimated cost I will pass to Bill on in terms of the specific expenditure. I don't know, Bill, if you want to outline the
costs involved in the creation of ScotRail Trains Limited, or do you mean the costs of the of ScotRail ScotRail Trains once it is commenced?
No, not clarity. The operational part of it. The cost of the transfer of operations.
The transfer will. So expenditure to date on that transfer, if I may, Minister, is currently sat at 3.6 million year to date. Of course, we are now in the last month and there will be further expenditure. Inevitably, there's a big peak of workload at the end of this this exercise, so there'll be a little bit more to add to that. My own reflection on that is, having run the previous franchise competition, which costs us about, I'm forever shocked at the cost of such processes, but last franchising cost us around 10 million from memory. I can dig out the figure if you want it, but from memory it was around 10 million. So, though I still remain struck at the scale of what's involved in a large, complex, contractual set of transfers like this, it is nonetheless substantially cheaper than that alternative option.
Thank you, Mr. Reeve. The 3.6 million year to date, what would you expect? Now, we won't hold you to this number. What would you expect the final estimated total cost to be in terms of ballpark figure?
What if I said under five? But I don't know with certainty. I'm very happy to come back. Clearly, it would be easier for me to give you that figure after the 1st of April if you don't mind.
And that includes all any contractual compensation. That's an all-in figure in terms of the costs associated with the transfer.
I'm not mindful of any contractual compensation. Did you have something in mind there?
No, I was just covering
the bases. I'm not. So, well, I haven't got any contractual compensation in the budget. I'm not anticipating.
Okay. So. Good to know. Okay, well, that's enough for me at the moment. Let me pass to Fiona Hislop.
Thank you and good morning. The committee has heard that as we go through the different stages of the coronavirus pandemic, that the rail industry is going to have to better understand passenger needs and flex services accordingly. So how do you intend to create a railway that's focused on meeting the current needs of rail passengers? And I might add that you can only just get a seat on the Linlithgow to Edinburgh rush hour trains, so obviously passengers are coming back in on that line. But how are you going to adapt to meet the needs of those who could travel by rail but are choosing not to? So you've talked already, Minister, about the current situation of people travelling at the weekends, etc. But that step change that we're going to need, what are you planning or thinking of how we can attract more people back onto the railway and those that could be using rail but aren't using it? And I suspect price may well be an issue.
So I thank Fiona Hislop for that question. There is a real challenge here at the moment in terms of encouraging people back safely onto the railways, and she spoke to some of the challenges on her local service, and I'd be happy to take some of that away to ScotRail. I raised a question myself about carriages just last week, actually, on the Mark Interchange service. So I recognise we're seeing patronage shift, we're seeing folk returning to rail. And the other thing I think we need to take cognizance of, and we had a discussion at our director's call yesterday, is the cost of living costs and fuel prices and what that means for people in terms of choosing to use public transport now in a way that they might not have done before. So we need to think about how our public transport networks, and I include ScotRail in that, are preparing for that return to patronage and people coming back to our railways, and best support ScotRail to do that. I think it's important that we get our messaging on this right. We need to do that safely. I've had a number of conversations with the rail unions on how we might be able to do that around about, for example, a communications campaign that helps support people back to our railways. But you're absolutely right to say that we need to look at stock, for example. We need to ensure that there's enough space on our trains, that people feel safe. There's still a requirement at the moment, for example, to wear face coverings on our trains, and people need to feel that they're able to go back and use our railways and access their work and employment safely, but also I think support that transition back into a semblance of normality after the pandemic is over. So it's hugely important that we do that, and we communicate that via work with the trade unions, and I'm looking at how we might be able to better do that through our national conversation. Primarily, I think, as we move to public ownership, the convener said he wasn't able to identify any substantial, I suppose, changes. But it does mean that our railways are accountable to ministers. So if there are problems, ministers are answerable to Parliament, to this committee, and we can enact change directly, and I think in a way that we weren't able to do prior to public ownership. So I'm really keen that the national conversation helps us to gather that data, but also helps us to provide the public with a sense of pride in the new publicly owned ScotRail and a sense of ownership of it. And it's hugely important we support that safe return to our railways, as the member alludes to, working with our rail unions and thinking too about how we might be better able to communicate that with local authority partners, for example, and other stakeholders. I know Transport Scotland officials have undertaken a bit of work on this additionally, which Bill may want to say more on, but it is a challenge and it's one that has been raised with me by the unions on a number of occasions now.
So you talked a lot about return there. I was talking about return to rail. I was asking about new passengers, you know, people who could use it but aren't using it.
Yeah. So I think that question links potentially to people who are still fearful then to come back to rail, or is it people who've never considered using railway in the first instance? So I think that speaks to the wider question around about affordability, and we may come on to speak about fares increases. Members around the table will be aware that fares in Scotland are 20% cheaper than the rest of the UK. However, I recognise there has been a 3.8% increase in fare prices, and that may put some people off. One of the things we're looking at in government just now is the Fair Fares Review, which looks across different modes of public transport to see where we might be able to better join up journeys, for example. And I think that's a key way in which we can encourage people who might be reticent to use rail to join up rail to bus provision, for example, and to join up our approach to ticketing additionally, which we've provided funding to bus companies to enact smart ticketing, for example. And I think the Fair Fares Review gives us an opportunity, although I will say to the committee it's at its planning stages at this moment in time, but it does give us an opportunity to look more broadly at how we can encourage people out of their cars, supporting that modal shift onto our railways and getting those people that, as Ms Hislop speaks to, might not have considered using the train in the past.
Can I move on to decarbonisation? Obviously a key part of the future of the new publicly owned controlled railways. Could you maybe give us some more detail about the implementation of the Rail Decarbonisation Action Plan and any details on any individual scheme delivery and likely budgets? And I'm interested particularly in what you're talking about in battery in terms of what you're planning on that, and also any interests particularly in any move to hydrogen at any point.
I thank Ms Hislop for her question. As you'll know, we've already announced our plans for the electrification of the Glasgow to Barrhead lines by December of 23 and the new Leavenmouth line by spring of 24. We're also making good progress finalising our proposals on the electrification of the East Kilbride, Fife and Borders lines, and we continue to develop our decarbonisation plans across the entire Scottish rail network. Decarbonising transport more broadly, though, is one of the six themes that have been set out in the draft STPR2 report published in February of this year. And I know STPR2, I think, was raised at the evidence session last week. The procurement of that new rolling stock, though, forms an integral part of the decarbonisation action plan that Ms Hislop spoke to. And we're building on that track record of delivering electrification on Scotland's rail network. So pre-pandemic, 75% of all passenger journeys and 45% of freight services in Scotland were made on electric services. So good work, but clearly more to do. And I think to some extent the pandemic gives us an impetus really to focus on driving that improvement further. I know that Transport Scotland and Network Rail and ScotRail are working in partnership with officials to ensure that programme moves forward. And I think too, though, it speaks to the wider opportunities that Ms Hislop touched upon around supporting passengers who might not have considered using rail in the past back to travelling on our networks, knowing that they're clean and decarbonised, and therefore I think in terms of their carbon footprint, people might be more inclined to choose rail than they might have been in the past. Bill might want to say more on the decarbonisation action plan specifically.
Well, I suppose I'd add, Minister, is that we're working hard with our colleagues in Network Rail and in ScotRail to turn those plans that we've already announced for the Borders and for Fife into reality. So, for example, as we proceed with the construction of the Leavenmouth branch, we're taking the opportunity now to put up the electrification infrastructure, even though it will be 2 or 3 years beyond that before we can actually start to run the trains to the service. Why are we doing that? Because we're looking ahead with the benefit of that 2035 plan to the network we need to build. We're looking at how our rolling stock plans for the replacement of existing fleets require us to get the wires in place so we can buy the electric trains rather than replacing diesels with more expensive hydrogen trains. All of that planning is underway, and we're working very hard with our colleagues in Network Rail in particular to drive down the cost of the electrification to render this affordable, and Scotland, I'm pleased to say, is leading the way in that respect in comparison with costs south of the border. So this is a huge bit of what my team and colleagues across what we call Team Scotland, Network Rail and ScotRail, is working on at the moment.
I think, additionally, Ms. Hislop raised a question around about battery-operated trains and hydrogen potentially as another opportunity. There are parts of the rail infrastructure, rail network, that lend itself more obviously than others to that infrastructure. So I think the Far North Line and other lines, we're looking at what the opportunities might be there for bringing that technology in where electrification might not work.
Yes, so there's a big capital cost with electrification, but a much lower operating cost. Typically, this is rule of thumb, but typically, an ordinary electric unit, if you take that as a starting point, a battery electric unit probably adds about a third to the cost. And at the current state of technology, a hydrogen train might add 80%. To the cost, both in terms of first cost and in terms of operating cost thereafter. A lot of work going on, including the work we're doing with the hydrogen train at Bowness to see how we can explore that and drive down the cost of those alternative technologies, but that's kind of the rule of thumb. So hydrogen for the longer, more lightly used lines, as the Minister said, is a very promising technology.
Okay, thank you, Fiona. Liam Kerr has a supplementary in this area, to be followed by Natalie Dawn, who is joining us remotely. Liam, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'm very grateful. Just on that point that's just been made, around 50% of the ScotRail rolling stock, I understand, is pre-94. Now, I think that makes it around 500 carriages and all of the 25 HST sets, which I think are life expired by 2030. So the question then becomes, is there a plan and a time frame to replace the pre-94 sets and fit that precisely to the electrification programme and timescales?
Yeah, so we'll have to obviously replace the 2030 stock that Mr Kerr spoke to, and I know he raised the issue with me regarding a break clause, I think, last week in the Chamber. I've spoken to officials about how we might be able to look at that. I don't think there is currently a break clause in the contract bill, can correct me if I'm wrong, but we are looking, of course, at planning for the future, because these trains are not going to be with us forever. They are older trains, as Mr Kerr knows, some of them date from the 1970s, so it's essential that we do that and we build in that electrification requirement that we will need for our decarbonised network in the future.
But is there an actual plan, Minister? Because there'll be life expired by 2030, so one would have thought, if they're pre-94, we need to do the decarbonisation that Ms Hislop rightly brings up. So is there a plan to replace the pre-94? And if not, when will there be?
There is a plan. I will allow Bill to come in on the detail of it, because if there wasn't one, we wouldn't have any trains, obviously, to run the network. We wouldn't have enough. So it's essential that we have that plan in place. But I'll bring Bill in on the specifics.
So thank you. So there is a plan being worked through with our colleagues in ScotRail, and indeed with NetRail. As I said earlier, we need to have a programme that aligns the infrastructure investment, the electrification, with the rolling stock replacement plan. Our first phase of that plan will be the procurement of a fleet of new electric and some battery electric EMUs. We know that, for example, if I look at the diesel fleets that we have, we are looking to the Class 156s coming out of service first in the next 5 years or so, looking at the HSTs and the Class 158 diesels by 2030. And that would leave our last diesel fleet, the Class 170s, which we're currently anticipating will run until 2035. All of that could change. That's over a long time scale. But our planning for that decarbonisation programme takes all of that into account, including looking at the phased replacement of the older electric fleet we already have in the west of the country.
Grateful. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Liam. Let me bring in Natalie Dawn, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning, panel. We've touched on smart ticketing this morning. This committee and all of our predecessors have heard calls for better integration between rail and other forms of transport and the creation of that smart ticketing model. And the Minister, you've touched on this already. I'm just wondering, can we have an update on the Fair Fares review in terms of the immediate priorities and what stage this is at, and what other steps are being taken by Transport Scotland to bring these about?
So, I thank Natalie Dawn for that question. I touched on this, I think, in my initial response to the convener. The Fair Fares Review is part of that broader programme of work that is being taken forward by officials at the moment to look at sustainable transport system for the future, but also, I think, importantly, to look at joining up transport modes and not thinking about them in silos. So immediate priorities for that work are looking at the current COVID-19 conditions, so what's patronage telling us, for example, but also looking at the COVID-19 strategic framework. I think that is important. The pandemic hasn't gone away. So whilst in my response to Ms Hislop, I talked about encouraging people back to rail, we have to do that in a way that's safe and in line with the current guidance. We don't know when the next Omicron variant, for example, might be around the corner, and therefore we need to plan for that accordingly. And we need for people to feel confident too, and I think that was the issue that Ms Hislop raised regarding people's return to, or perhaps they're choosing, for example, the first time to travel by rail. As I mentioned, the Fair Fares Review itself is currently in its planning stages, and work is being undertaken to look at that sustainable and integrated approach. It will look, for example, at a range of different discounts and also at the concessionary schemes which are available on all modes of transport, and I think that's important. So we're looking at bus, rail and ferry and joining up those opportunities better, and it will also take cognizance of the costs and availability of services. And I think that's hugely important when we talk about the cost of living, for example, and the cost of public transport, and trying to facilitate that modal shift to get people out of their cars and onto using train, for example. I do have a submission, I should say, to members in my inbox at the moment, which gives more options on the associated timescales for the Fair Fares Review. So once I've made a decision on that, convener, I'd be more than happy to share that with the committee and come back and discuss further the work in detail, because, as I say, it is at the interim planning stages at this moment in time.
Thank you, Minister, for that answer. And just following on from that, I'm not sure if we're at that stage yet, but has there been any reluctance from private operators around an integrated ticketing system, or, as I say, have we not got to that stage yet?
Not that I am aware of. I don't think we've probably got to that stage yet in terms of consultation. And, of course, with regard to ScotRail, we'll have one national operator, so I suppose the pushback from ScotRail won't exist in the same way that it might in other sections, I suppose, in terms of our transport network. But I'm not cited on that thus far.
Thank you. Just moving on to a different issue. Obviously, we've touched on antisocial behaviour, and last week the RMT highlighted concerns around the increase in antisocial behaviour. Yeah. Specifically focusing on women, I know this is something that's already been made a priority, and given the national conversation and the consultation that's going to be released, it's really important that this filters through to the real world, to women that use the services and rely on them. Mm-hmm. So how do we ensure that we do hear from women in the real world who are out there using these services and experiencing these problems?
I think Natalie Dawn raises a really important point. And when I look back, I suppose, at the statement, which was maybe a couple of weeks after I was appointed, women's experiences on public transport are, in the main, not particularly positive, I think it's fair to say. There's a number of different ranges of evidence we can draw upon to quantify that, but not least, of course, the BTP survey, I think, which was carried out last year and looked at comparable data from 2019 and women's experience of sexual harassment on the London Underground network, I think, specifically, which saw over a 60% increase in that time frame. And I think that the pandemic has potentially changed behaviour, so we need to get more data specifically for Scotland on this, and I'm meeting with BTP on this because they've been leading on a campaign specifically on sexual harassment, and members may have seen, if they travel by rail regularly as I do, the signs at our local train stations, which I would be keen to explore further with BTP. But I think there's a broader conversation we have to have around about women's safety on public transport and what that looks like. So are we just talking about on the train? Are we talking about the journey to the train? There are wider ramifications we need to consider. Now, Ms Dawn asks about how we will ensure that women's voices are heard. So I gave an undertaking in my opening statement that we've already engaged with Engender, who will be meeting with soon to discuss this further, looking at other women's organisations too. But she's absolutely right. We need to speak to real-life women and make sure that we've got a real service that meets their needs and make sure that they feel safe to use our trains late at night, for example. In my own limited experience, which I shared with the Chamber, it's not always a safe place to get the last train back to your house on a Friday night, which shouldn't be the case in 2022. So we need to work better at ensuring our trains are safe spaces for women. And actually on this, I'd just like to again thank the rail unions for their contributions on this. They've had some really positive things to say. Now, Ms Dawn spoke about some of the challenges around about antisocial behaviour. future. I recognise some of these are linked actually to women's experiences additionally of travel on our trains, but also to staff's experiences throughout the pandemic. And I think it's important to thank and remember that ScotRail staff went above and beyond during the pandemic. They were getting people to their work, but they were also at work. They were essential workers throughout the pandemic. So I just want to again thank them for that and recognise that they are at the forefront often of some pretty difficult and challenging behaviour. So it's absolutely important we ensure in government that there's support there. Now, BTP have a statutory requirement to provide that support. As I mentioned, I'll be meeting with them later, I think, this week, if not the week after. But it's really important that we get this work right and that we do ensure that staff feel safe coming to work, women feel safe travelling on our trains, and that the vision that we're trying to build for the new public ownership of ScotRail is one that best reflects the needs of the passengers who use it.
Thank you, Minister. Back to convener.
Thank you very much, Natalie. Monica Lennon has a supplemental in this area. Monica, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. And I recognise a lot of what has been said about safety, particularly for women. Something that concerned me last year was reports in the media that there's been a consistent trend of girls assaulting other girls on trains, particularly in the west of Scotland. And British Transport Police described it as a consistent trend. So I wondered what discussions, Minister, you've had with BTP on that regard, and referencing back to Mick Hogg from RMT Scotland last week, who was very complimentary about his early talks with you, Minister. He also talked about taking tougher action on known perpetrators of antisocial behaviour. In terms of young girls, because I think this cohort are decided between 12 and 16, I don't think banning them off the trains might be the answer, but is there wider work going on in terms of school, youth engagement, to find out what's at the root of this kind of antisocial behaviour, which is difficult for passengers and for staff?
So Monica Lennon raises a really important point. I did see the reports on this at the time. I've not yet met with BTP, but I do intend to raise it with them. It does seem to be a specific issue in the west of Scotland at this moment in time. I'm not cited, for example, on any statistics in Fife or in other parts of the country where it might be playing out. I think on the wider work with schools, I'd be really keen to support that. I think our schools, as you will know, are really important places to try and challenge and tackle antisocial behaviour, but also to ensure that communities' voices are heard when things are not working on our rail network in particular. I think that there are often challenges presented at staff's door that they have to move people on, for example. So I had a really good conversation with Mick Hogg about this 2 weeks ago now. And ScotRail have an approach, for example, whereby they will use teams of staff and they are remobilising staff to get out and about and to move antisocial behaviour on. So I had a conversation with Mick about this and others who were of the view that sometimes when these teams come out, they just move the behaviour elsewhere. So it's not actually helping to contain it and tackle it. So this is an issue that I'd like to take up further with BTP, because there are shared responsibilities here, but also as we move forward with public ownership, I think she's absolutely correct. We need to ensure that there is safety on board for passengers, but also for staff. Now, the wider issue that she raises, Ms Lennon raises, around about that tougher action, was raised with me by the unions by way potentially of looking at legislation. And I might bring in Bill on this specific point, because we have not raised it further with the unions, but I'm not ruling it out. And I think if there is an opportunity to look at how we might better support staff in this endeavour, then I'm keen to look at all options. So.
Well, just to add, Minister, that we have said the specific issue is there aren't powers for the banning of people who exhibit antisocial behaviour on trains in the way that there are, for example, powers to ban people from attendance at football matches. Mm-hmm. And it's something where we've commenced discussions with Justice colleagues. It's something we'd like to follow up with the British Transport Police and with Justice colleagues, and certainly something we feel deserves further consideration.
Yeah, I think there was, from memory, with the discussions with the union, a feeling of unfairness that the legislation didn't extend to railway workers in the same way that it might in other parts of society.
Well, question to answer, isn't it? As to why one wouldn't be able to prevent folk who are known to exhibit behaviours that are unreasonable to passengers and staff, well, beyond unreasonable for passengers and staff, why there wouldn't be powers to prevent them from using those services. So it's something to be followed through.
And I think that was a frustration that certainly I heard in conversations with the unions, was that there would be people identified in terms of their behaviour and they would be back on the train the next day or in a couple of hours, and it was quite demoralising for staff. So we have to look again at the provisions in the legislation. working with BTP to ensure that we get this right. I like Bill, share the view of the unions on this, and I want to make sure that public ownership of the railways doesn't rule anything out and that we look at all the available opportunities to us open to consider how we can support staff, because nobody deserves to go to their work and, you know, face abuse, for example. And some of the conditions, I think, that our railway staff were working under during the pandemic were quite challenging.
So there is a willingness there to actually put into practice a zero tolerance towards any antisocial behaviour criminality on the railways. Just finally then, can I ask that scoping exercise perhaps around the potential for legislation, will that form part of the work around the national conversation that you're taking forward?
I don't want to preclude it from the national conversation. To my mind, probably not, because I would like to follow up with justice officials, and we'll do this after committee, and I'm happy to share information with Ms Lennon on this additionally, because I think we may have a specific legislative fix there which might not be part of a wider national conversation. I don't want to preclude it at this point, but I think they're probably two separate things.
Thank you very much, Monica. Jackie Dunbar, please.
Good morning, Minister. You mentioned in your opening statement that the Scottish Government has started the national conversation on the future of the rail services. And I've heard some of the answers you've been given today. What exactly would you like to come out of the national conversation? What would you like to get back from the folk of Scotland? What do you want to hear from them? And how do you think the results will be implemented once you have heard back?
I thank Ms Dunbar for her question. I don't want to prejudge the outcome of this consultation, but I think from my perspective, we need to first of all establish what is currently working in the system, because it's not all a challenge or a problem. There are some things that are great about our railways. In fact, there are many things, as Bill will tell you, about our railways which are fantastic and work really well. And I think we shouldn't throw the baby out with the bathwater. However, there are clearly issues in terms of the challenges that the public will face. So I think it's important to identify where those are, where people feel unsafe, for example, returning to using our railways, how we can best support people to use our railway network. But I think, to me, the overriding thing should be that I would like people to feel a sense of pride in ownership of Scotland's railways. At the end of the day, there will be publicly owned trains. They belong to the people, so they have to be fit for purpose for the needs of the travelling public. Now, I recognise we've got a journey to go on here, but that's why I think I committed to the consultation of the rather the national conversation, because it's really important that this is not just a process or a ticking box exercise that we move into public ownership and nothing changes. I think something probably will have to change. I think it should change, but we need to make sure that when we make those changes, the public feel as though those changes are working for them. If they're not working for them, then we've got it wrong and we'll have to start again. And I think that's really important. You've got to respond to as a government and listen to the needs of the public. And public ownership gives us a real opportunity to do that. And the second thing I suppose I would say on establishing where we are just now is the railway unions and industrial relations, I think, as the committee will be aware, have been a bit fraught in recent months. I have been really keen to try and do my best to listen directly to our railway unions. So we had a really good meeting of all the unions together at the end of term on Teams. And then I've had most of my meetings last week and a couple the week before in person with the railway unions, building relationships, listening to them. And a lot of what our railway unions have to say is what our passengers want anyway. So there's a natural link here too. But we need to better understand that in government and reflect it, I think, in the delivery of services too.
Okay. And also the new government arrangements, can you maybe explain to me what systems are already in place or you'd like to establish to ensure that our ScotRail services provide best value as well as value for money for both our passengers and our taxpayers?
Yeah, I think that's a really important question that Ms Dunbar asks. First of all, in terms of the structures that we're using, I did set this out in my opening statement, but ScotRail Holdings is wholly owned by the Scottish Government and has been set up to give that oversight and management of the train service delivery by ScotRail Trains. So I am accountable as Minister, as the sole shareholder, or Ministers rather, of SRH, and ministerial responsibilities include keeping the Parliament informed about SRH's performance. So if members have views on how best we can do that, I'd be keen to hear those, if that should be done on a quarterly basis, for example, or if this committee would like to seek updates on this quarterly. I think that's actually quite important. I want us to have a responsive approach to running Scotland's trains in the future, and that means the government has to listen and act accordingly. I also have, our ministers have responsibility to approve SRH's strategic plan and also to approve its budget. And that, I think, gives answer to Jackie Dunbar's points regarding value for money and overall accountability to the Chamber, but also to this committee. And again, if Ms Dunbar or other members have views on how we can best share that information with members after April the 1st, I'm keen to hear those. And to be as transparent, I think, as possible, it's really important that we do that under public ownership. I don't know if Bill wants to say more on the value for money aspects of the strategic arrangements that have been established, or actually, sorry, Jan may want to say more on the legalities of the kind of approach that we've adopted.
Perhaps just the one thing to say is that in all of this governance, we talk about what are the priorities for Scotland's railway. It's about net zero, net cost, and safety. We have to make the railways affordable to the taxpayer so they can play the much bigger part. So even in the transition to the creation of ScotRail Holdings Limited, part of that transition work we're doing, we've looked at the opportunities to make savings in some of the contracts that ScotRail needs, for example, the rolling stock. So we're always looking through these governance arrangements for the opportunities to improve the value in the delivery of the service. And part of that transition project cost has actually secured some really quite meaningful savings in rolling stock leases. So I think that's a good illustration of how we will use these governance arrangements to drive value into delivery.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. That's all I have.
Okay, thank you very much, Jackie. Next. Sorry, Jan, did you want to come in on the Minister mentioned some questions over the legal side? Did you want to respond to that?
Thank you. I can just confirm that there will be a framework agreement between the Scottish Ministers and Scottish Rail Holdings, which will set out governance arrangements, roles and responsibilities, and Scottish Rail Holdings' accountabilities to Transport Scotland, the Scottish Ministers and the Scottish Parliament in connection with ScotRail operations and the discharge of ministers' duties under Section 30 of the Railways Act. Thank you.
No, that's totally fine, Jackie. And John, just on that, when will that framework, is it publicly available, or will it in due course be publicly available?
It will be publicly available in due course.
Fantastic. Jackie, thank you. Monica, I believe you have further questions.
Oh, back to me. Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to come back to trade union engagement, because it was a useful session last week and the Minister already made several references to her many meetings with trade unions, and it sounds like it's quite positive. I don't know if this has been superseded, but last week we'd heard from the TSSA union some concerns that the offer for union representation at board level with a new ScotRail, it wasn't clear if that was going to be a trade union or staff representative place or just a regular board member place. Has that been bottomed out?
I think it has, but I will tell the member where we are just now. So at the current time, the offer has been made for a full board member on as a statutory, which would mean that the trade union representative has a statutory company director position. And I know that an offer has been made to unions to that effect. Now, I am aware that an individual has been nominated by the four unions, but the process of that appointment hasn't yet concluded, and the name has therefore not been made public. So members will understand that I can't share that information, but I'd be happy to have further conversations with the unions on this. We have discussed it in the meetings we have had, but I don't think there's disagreement on this issue. I may be wrong, but I think that a name has been put forward and the union seem to be content with that, and that person would have full membership of the board, so they wouldn't be in an observer post, for example.
Good to get a further update on that.
Sure.
And the other question I think that needs to be mopped up from last week was around the no compulsory redundancy policy. Will that just carry over as per the union's wishes?
Well, it's not currently off the table, as Ms Lennon will know, and that's because we're in negotiation at this moment in time. There are a number of things that I think I've discussed with the unions, not least, for example, their views on ticket office closures. So we're having conversations at this moment in time, and those arrangements, or those engagements rather, are ongoing with between officials at ScotRail and unions directly. So it's not off the table. I heard Mick Hogg's comments on this, so I think the committee would be surprised if we went into public ownership and we didn't have a policy of no compulsory redundancies, but we're not there yet because we haven't established a pay deal. And I'd be very keen to get to that place with the unions, but of course those negotiations are ongoing, so I don't want to prejudge them.
So your own position, you're not in favour of compulsory redundancies in our railways?
I am not personally, however, that is still on the table at this moment in time because the negotiations are ongoing.
Thank you. It was interesting to hear, I think it was Bill Reeve who said that what the trade unions say pretty much aligns with what the public feel and are saying anyway. So I wonder, in terms of your engagement with the unions, the rail unions, what's your take on the document they've put forward, a vision for Scotland's railways? There are a number of recommendations. I won't run through them all. You'll be pleased to hear. But one, for example, is about not just a fare freeze, but to reduce ticket prices and to offer free rail travel for under 24s and over 60s, for example. Are these the kind of recommendations that you are sympathetic to, Minister?
So the document of vision for Scotland's railways puts forward a number of different ideas, some of which I'm supportive of. Others, we need to look at the costings associated with them. So Bill will come in probably on the detail of this, but some of what the unions have put forward would be financially, I think, inviable at this moment in time. On the fare freeze itself, I'm not ruling out looking at fares in the future. I recognise some of the challenge around about the fares increase, which happened at the end of last year, I think. And Ms Lennon puts forward a number of the suggestions around about under 24s and over 60s, for example. She will know, of course, we have the under 22 scheme, which I think I was here last week to talk briefly about, in terms of our bus operators. And I recognise some of the challenges here. I think the answer to some of these concessionary travel issues lies in the Fair Fares Review, because I think there's a requirement or a need, rather, to look across the piece, not just at rail in a silo. We need to look at bus, we need to look at joining up ferry journeys and making sure that timetables work for passengers and they can join up their journeys accordingly, and that concessionary fares, if they flow across different modes of transport. And so I'm not ruling out looking at these things in the future. What I would say is that they cost a lot of money, so we will need to look at budget lines associated with them. And I know officials have done some preparatory work around about the union's vision for Scotland's railway, which tells me it's going to be rather a lot of money, and we will need to think again about how we budget for those things in the past, but you know, in the future rather. But these are things that we will look at in the future with the support of the unions. I think a lot of the ideas in that document I am broadly sympathetic to. It's about how we finance them and how we find the budget for them in government, and I think that's the challenge going forward, because we recognise some of what we're facing just now is quite difficult. And we look at cost of living, for example. We need to make sure that our public transport system is fit for purpose but also is affordable for people. So I do hear some of the criticism that the unions have made on that point around about fare freezes and not ruling out in the future looking at that, what that might mean in the future for rail travel, because I think it's really important that folk can afford to use our railways, and that's a wider challenge, of course, as we move into public ownership and we make sure that our railways are sustainable but also efficient. Do you want to say more on the union report?
Well, I suppose just to say that I and some of my colleagues made a point of turning up to the presentation of that report during the COP26 conference. And one of the great strengths I found throughout my career in the railway industry is just the passion of railway staff for the success of the railway, for what it can do for society and everything else besides. It's a huge strength in the railway industry. So I found a lot in the report that was very easy to support. I was very interested in some of the challenging questions about our fare structures. You know, do peak fares make any sense when we don't have a peak anymore? Mm-hmm. There is a sort of a perennial challenge in railway management, railway financing, that there are in essence two ways in which the railway can be paid for. One is from the customer, be it the passenger or the freight customer, and the other is through the taxpayer. Yeah. And that's why the point about securing value for money and driving through the efficiency of delivery is so important. I think there's a lot to like in the union report. There's a big question about how much of it is affordable, and how we make it affordable. But a really, really valuable contribution to the vision for future Scotland's railway. My own personal view, if I'm permitted such a thing.
you are.
I mean, I suppose the good news is that we've demonstrated in Scotland already that it is affordable to, you know, make bus travel free for under 22s and for others. And there's obviously a wider campaign to extend that. I think the point the Minister makes about, you know, making sure that it's all joined up and integrated is important. I suppose my final question then is, in terms of this fares review, what is the timescale for that and how can the public engage with that?
As I mentioned, I think, in my answer to Natalie Dawn, I have a submission on this which sets out a number of options. So I will arrive at a decision imminently and I will be happy to share that with the committee. I think the current associated timescales may lead us to 2023. I'm keen to see results on this sooner than that. So I want to speak to officials about how we do that and how we best join up, as Ms Lennon has said, modes of different public transport options. We don't just look at rail narrowly on its own, but I think it's really important that we do this preparatory work. The other thing I think to be cognizant of is that patronage patterns at the moment are not what they were 2 years ago, and they're not hopefully what they will be in 2 years time. So when we're looking at the data, some of what we're seeing at this moment in time, it's difficult to prejudge how the public might feel in 3 months time, for example. And I mentioned earlier on, if there's another wave of Omicron, for example, or an equivalent, that might put people off returning to public transport. So we need to be cognizant of that too. But I don't have timescales to share with Ms Lennon just now. I do have the submission with me. And once I've made a decision on what that looks like, I'd be more than happy to share that with the committee. Given that we are at the planning preparatory stages just now, I don't have that detail to hand.
No, thank you. And again, because we are in a cost of living crisis and we know that many people are priced out of using the trains, it would be good to see that work accelerated. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Monica. Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, earlier on, Mr Reeve talked about the procurement of rolling stock and said that the new company might buy electric trains. Can you just clarify for me, will the new rolling stock be leased through Roscoe's, or is there a move to have train sets owned by the operator? And if it's the latter, is there a cost implication of that?
So the existing rolling stock that we have is already secured through lots of different leases, and it will be necessary to maintain some of those initially to keep the ScotRail fleet available for use. But we will look at future fleet procurement, and I think that offers us an opportunity to look at purchase or lease, which will be decided having regard to the availability of capital and resource budget funding. So we need to look at essentially the costs. Will it be cheaper or more expensive to lease or to buy? And that funding mechanism is going to be explored actively to look at how the fleet is procured with the balance of cost and that ownership risk too. So I had a conversation with officials about this yesterday around about what that would look like. So if in the future we look to purchase, for example, rolling stock, there will be associated risk with that, and we need to factor that in. In terms of value for money, my own personal view would be that we do look to, in the future, potentially own some of the rolling stock, because it may provide us with greater value for money in the longer term because we're not leasing them. But we all need to look at the financials involved in this. Bill may want to say more on this specifically.
Well, I think you're right, Minister. When we've conducted analysis before, the whole life ownership cost of a train that is owned rather than leased tends to be cheaper, but there's inevitably a question at the start about the availability of capital and how you allocate that most efficiently, and there is an established rolling stock leasing market in Britain. So I suppose we're in the nice position of having a choice, you know, about how we allocate that capital. But certainly short leases where at the end of 7 years you end up being charged the same price as if it was a new train because the lessor knows that you've got not very few choices is not a great way of securing best value either. We have taken some steps with some of the existing leases to get perhaps the best of both worlds. So the Caledonian Sleeper, the Scottish Government contributed approximately half the capital cost. So we own half of that fleet, working with the lessor for the rest. That's an interesting model that brings some of the strengths of both models. And each fleet we will need to take a decision appropriately as we approach that investment decision.
On the 4th of March, I read in the Scotsman, Alex Hines, saying that ScotRail's budget had yet to be fixed. Has that been done now? Is the budget fixed now?
Do you, Do you want me to comment on it?
Well, yeah, I'm happy for you to comment on the budget. I was of the view that it was, but...
So that the budget bill has a rail services line which, I'm just looking at my notes, has £719.5 million allocated for this year for rail services, of which £312 million is actually something called fixed track access charges, which are paid in the slightly Byzantine way that railway finances work, through the train operating companies and on to Network Rail, which leaves a budget of £407.5 million for the operation, or the remaining subsidy for Caledonian Sleeper and for ScotRail. What is not certain yet is what the revenue of ScotRail will be over this next year. We have learnt over the last 2 years how demand has gone up and down at different stages. You know, we were as low as under 10% of revenue at one point. At the minute, we're up to, on some Saturdays, we're up to pre-pandemic levels at the weekend, but we're bumping along the sort of 55 to 60% of revenue during on a weekday at the minute. And I think we can all look over the next year a range of very plausible scenarios that will take us to very different passenger demand and therefore revenue figures. So could I look you in the eye and say I am confident what the net cost of operating ScotRail over the next 12 months will be? No. But bluntly, that's not the same. That's not an issue of ownership. That's just an issue of the market conditions.
Yeah.
One more question, if I may, Convener. Minister, I'd like to go right back to the start of this session. Because the convener, I think, asked a really important question that I'm not sure I heard the answer to. Because he asked about what does nationalisation of the railway actually bring? And your answer involved relations with the trade unions, consideration of service cuts, consulting on ticket office cuts and other consultations. And you finished by saying the important thing is how to best meet passenger need. Public ownership will allow us to do that. And that's the bit I wasn't quite understanding, because it seems to me, post 1st of April, we have the same people, we have the same rolling stock, we have the same leasing arrangements in the short term, we have the same network, at a cost of £3.6 million, with potentially fewer ticket offices, fewer services. The issue that Monica Lennon raised about no compulsory redundancies, and you mentioned a possible fares increase. So the question begged is, what can a nationalised rail company do that the previous operator couldn't?
So I think the answer lies in accountability to ministers. So the franchise, ScotRail is now accountable directly to ministers, and ministers are accountable to Parliament, and they're accountable to this committee. And you talked about, Mr Kerr-Rally, you talked about passenger need. I think there's a place for passenger need to be met in the debates and the conversations and the discussions that we have in the Chamber, but also in this committee. I think it's hugely important. Now, Mr Kerr touched upon a number of different challenges that we've talked through in today's proceedings, and I'm very live to all of those challenges. We have to be pragmatic and realistic in that people walked away or weren't able to use our railways during the pandemic. And they weren't able to use our railways because they were told to stay at home. There was very good public health advice on that. But at the same time, we were providing emergency funding to allow the railways to continue. So we need to look about the sustainability of the revenue structures that we have in place for our railways. Just on the point about fares increases, there's no proposals for fare increases. That was a historic, point that was raised potentially by the last evidence session of the committee, whereby fares increased by 3.8%. There are no future proposals on that that I'm aware of. And on the ticket office closures, I have given an undertaking to the unions that I will work with them on this. I recognise the strength and feeling on it. But I do think this goes back to what will be different. Well, I think it's about accountability. And I think it's about making sure that ministers are held to account, but equally that we deliver a railway service that best meets communities' needs. Now, I know as a Fife MSP some of the challenges we face with the Abellio contract in the years leading up to where we are now. Some of the very real challenges around about not having enough seats on trains, for example, trains being cancelled, delays. I am very live to all of that. Do I think all of that's going to go away under public ownership? I hope some of it will be released, but at least there will be accountability to Parliament, and at least there will be ministerial oversight in the process. And I think that's hugely important. And the second point is, yes, some of the people will be the same, but these people are experts in their field. We would want these people to be in charge of running ScotRail trains, for example. But the new framework agreements, which of course will be shared with the committee as and when they're published, will allow for that ministerial oversight. And I think that's the main difference in this. Ministers are accountable, and the ScotRail Trains is accountable to ministers. And therefore, there is greater democracy, I think, in the way in which we hope to run Scotland's trains in the future that we don't currently have under the franchising network system that we currently use with Abellio. And I recognise some of the challenges that have existed there in the past. Bill may want to say more on the opportunities, I suppose, it presents, but to my mind, it is about accountability.
Not so much the opportunities, just if I may, Bill, it's about what the nationalised rail company can do that the previous operator couldn't. You've said, Minister, I accept this, you've said it's the accountability. That is what's different in your view. But Mr Reeve, do you have anything to add?
Just one reflection, and that's about how things can be changed and the difference between negotiating a change with a contract, which was set out 7 or 8 years previously and for things that you thought were a good idea at the time, but the world's moved on. And any negotiation is, well, just that, a negotiation, as distinct from the ability to agree and direct changes under public ownership. And I first met that principle when a visit to the Railways of Victoria in Australia, where the government was looking at investing in the system, and for two of their bits of the system, they took those back out to franchise, but the bit that they were investing in substantial change, they chose to keep in-house for a period because that facilitated managing those changes more easily during that period. And the speed with which we may be able to respond to changes in market condition, I think, will be easier under these arrangements than would be the case under contractual arrangements.
I think, too, just in terms of our responsibilities, so I think this was in a response to Jackie Dunbar earlier on, so keeping the Parliament informed about ScotRail Holdings' performance, there is a requirement that ministers will have to do that now, approving SRH's strategic plan and approving its budget too. There is that accountability built into the new arrangements, and I think that that does allow for greater scrutiny, actually, from members like Mr Kerr on behalf of their constituents that we don't currently have under the Abellio franchise.
Okay, thank you, Liam. Let me pass over to Fiona Hislop.
So, Minister, you'll be aware that the committee is obviously interested in what is continuity and what is the opportunity for change. I want to move us on to Network Rail. Network Rail is going to be subsumed by Great British Railways. So, could you provide us an update on the discussions between the UK and Scottish governments on the development of Great British Railways and how it will operate in Scotland? What will be the responsibility and powers of Scottish ministers? And clearly, the interaction between the new ScotRail and Network Rail when it comes to new lines or even potentially new stations to help get commuters out of their cars and onto rail, this relationship will be very important. So could you provide us what would be continuity and what would be potentially change in that relationship?
Yeah, so I think, well, first of all, we're really clear that a devolved railway, public sector controlled and operated in the service of the public, which is fully integrated, as Ms Hislop spoke to, and truly accountable, as I mentioned in discussions with Mr Kerr, is going to deliver that better and more efficient service for Scotland's communities. And as part of the rail review, Scottish ministers and officials presented a clear case for the full devolution of rail powers, but the UK government plan outlined in the White Paper did not deliver on that. Now, I know that Transport Scotland officials are engaging with the DfT on further clarity on the detail of the White Paper, and I will probably bring in Bill on this because I have not been involved in any conversations with GBR on this issue thus far in post. I do appreciate, though, that the committee took evidence from GBR, I think, at last week's evidence session, so I have familiarised myself with that, and I'm looking forward to meeting with GBR in due course. There are a number of issues here around about continuity, but also I think challenges potentially going forward, but I was heartened to see some of the comments from GBR last week with regard to that working closely together and recognising, of course, devolution and the different roles and responsibilities involved in terms of our railways.
Thank you. Well, I suppose that the honest answer to the question is, are we clear how this will be applied in Scotland? The answer is no. Yeah. We do not yet know. We have not yet seen firm proposals. We do have, I'm pleased to say, a very constructive relationship with our sort of fellow officials in working for the Department of Transport and the UK government. But there is as yet nothing settled, as I understand. There are, I suppose, three broad principles in the GBR reform. One is the bringing together of the management of the track and train in the interests of, you know, more efficiency, better service. I think we'd strongly agree with that. It's what we've been trying to do in Scotland for a number of years. The second is a clearly stated principle that the devolved responsibility of devolved administrations will continue to be respected for rail as established. Well, that's the least we would expect. The third is there should be a single controlling mind for the railways of Great Britain, and it's not yet clear how you could reconcile that third one with the first two in Scotland, and that's the area that we are looking for further discussions with UK government.
Thank you. That might be something the committee might want to take further as that develops.
Okay, thank you, Fiona. We're running up against the clock. Minister, a final question for you. I want to come back to the proposed service cuts raised earlier, because I understand that you campaigned against those cuts last year, including a number of proposed cuts to services in Fife. Is that still your position?
Before I was Transport Minister, raised concerns on behalf of my constituents about a reduction in services in the local area. I'm aware, though, that patronage at this moment in time has not regained to where it was prior to the pandemic. So I recognise that the ScotRail Fit for the Future consultation, which was undertaken during the pandemic, has sought to reduce a number of services. However, ScotRail, I think it would have been February the 14th, did commit to reinstating, I think, over 150 services, if I'm not wrong. So therefore, I think that's an improvement from the initial consultation. My own view is that we need to have a railway service that meets passenger demand. At this moment in time, patronage is not there yet. So Bill gave an outline of where we are in terms of the stats. I think it's around about 60% at the moment.
About sort of 55-60 during the week, but much stronger
at the weekend. Saturday. Absolutely. So we've seen a complete shift in patronage, which is that people are using railways at the weekend and not as much the week because people are working from home. And I think we need to be cognizant of that in terms of the timetable delivery and what that means for the travelling public. However, would I like to see more trains in the future? Yes, absolutely. But we need to get patronage up to where it was prior to the pandemic to justify the action, I think.
Okay. So do you see a scenario where, with COVID restrictions being lifted, people returning to the office, commuters commuting from Fife to Edinburgh and elsewhere, do you see a scenario where pre-COVID levels of service will be reinstated?
I would hope that we will get to that place. However, it does depend on patronage, and it depends on people's behaviour in terms of whether or not they choose to work from home. Hybrid working, I think, is with us. We have an example of it here today. The Parliament's been a great example of hybrid working throughout the pandemic, and we can't account for what that might mean in the future. I think prior to the pandemic, none of us might have imagined working remotely as politicians, and yet we've all learnt to cope with it over the course of the last 2 years. I would like us to get back to a more sustainable footing on our railway provision, but that will require passenger demand to increase at the same time, and I think we need to reflect that better and timetabling in the future.
Okay, I believe Liam Kerr has a supplemental.
Very briefly, if I may, Convener, I'm going to go local, and this will not surprise you, Minister, I don't think at all. STPR2 doesn't allow for Fraserburgh and Peterhead into Aberdeen to be relayed. Does that mean that the government's mind is closed to these lines now, or would you be receptive to ordering a feasibility study into these lines?
I am not going to give Mr Kerr an undertaking to the feasibility study right now, but what I would say is that STPR2 is out to public consultation at this moment in time until, I think, next month. So I'd encourage Mr Kerr and other members to please respond to that public consultation. Additionally, STPR2 does not preclude campaigns such as that in his region from coming forward. So actually, Leadmouth Rail Link, for example, had, I think, two stag options appraisals and then another options appraisal before the railway line, am I right, was approved. So there were two different processes and then a final options appraisal that was considered before we gave approval to that line. So I'm not ruling out any lines out in the future. STPR2 is quite a high-level document. It doesn't preclude these local lines from coming forward in the future, and I appreciate that Mr Kerr has written to me on this, and I know the campaign group have too. I'd be more than happy to meet with them and with Mr Kerr to discuss this in detail, because it was one of the first things I did when I was first selected, was meet with Mr Youssef and campaign on behalf of my constituents for the Leadmouth Rail Link, and look where we are now.
I'd be very grateful, and I look forward to setting that up, Minister.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. That brings us to the end of our allocated time. Minister, thank you to you and your officials for taking part in this evidence session. It is greatly appreciated. The committee will have a private discussion on the evidence given later in this meeting. I now suspend the meeting for a few minutes before the next public agenda item. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. Our next agenda item is the consideration of three petitions. I refer members to paper three, which provides some background information on each petition and outlines possible options. The first petition we will consider is petition 1750, independent monitoring of satellite tags fitted to raptors. The petition was lodged by Alex Hogg on behalf of the Scottish Gamekeepers Association in August 2019. It's calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce independent monitoring of satellite tags fitted to raptor species to assist the police and courts in potential wildlife crime cases and to provide data transparency. This is the first time this petition is being considered by this committee. I now invite views from members, noting in particular the options set out in paragraph 15 of the paper. Let me begin by exploring some options that we can take forward this petition. My view is that we should keep this petition open. One option is to write to key stakeholders such as NatureScot and Police Scotland to gather views on the implementation of the new data sharing protocols in the first year. The predecessor committee kept the petition open on the basis that there were still concerns over the robustness of the data gathered. I think that's an area that we can explore with Nature Scotland and Police Scotland. The other option we have is to write to the Scottish Government asking what action has been taken by the Scottish Government following the Werity report to address these concerns. And once we get responses from that correspondence, the committee can consider appropriate next steps, including whether to keep the petition open following correspondence. Are members agreed? And does any member have other options to consider? Agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, fantastic. We will take those actions and follow up with correspondence. The next petition is petition 1815, translocate protected beavers to reduce licensed killing. This petition was lodged by Steve Micklewright on behalf of Trees for Life in August 2020. It's calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to initiate a programme to translocate protected beavers to suitable habitats outside existing beaver ranges to minimise the need to kill animals adversely impacting arable farmland. The committee first considered this petition a couple of months ago on 30th of November 2021. Following that meeting, the committee requested more information from NatureScot and the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity to inform our consideration. We have also received an update from the petitioner. Again, I now invite views from members in terms of how to progress this petition. The options we have, which I think we should explore, is to write to NatureScot and the Scottish Government seeking further information and clarification on issues raised in their letters. In particular, the committee could ask NatureScot to respond to the petitioner's claim that NatureScot continues to rely on their argument that once they have decided to issue a licence, the law does not require them to license the least harmful activity, such as translocation before lethal control. As far as we know, beavers are the only protected species that are treated in this way. I think that is an important point, and I think it's an area that we should seek clarification on. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Thank you very much. One other option is to write to the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee to ask whether beaver management is something that could be addressed through their future work programme through consideration of new rural support schemes which will or could be considered in due course by that committee. And also, if committee members are agreed to that correspondence to the RAIN committee, the committee could write in similar terms to the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. Finally, the third petition for consideration this morning is petition 1872, Improve the Reliability of Island Ferry Services. Again, this petition was lodged by Liz McNichol in May 2021 and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to urgently ensure that all islanders have access to reliable ferry services. As with petition 1815, the committee first considered this petition a couple of months ago on the 30th of November 2021. Following that meeting, the committee decided to request more information from Caledonian McBrain and the Minister for Transport. You will note that we have also received two submissions relevant to the petition since we last considered it from residents on Tyree and Mull, which have been impacted by the reliability of island ferry services. I now invite views from members, noting in particular the option set out in paragraph 42 of the paper, and I also remind members that we will be undertaking a discussion on our work programme in private after this public meeting. Given that we are going to be discussing our work programme, I think the best option in this situation is that we come back to this petition once we have agreed our work programme in the weeks ahead, because I think the subject matter of this petition might very well be covered in the future work of this committee. We also have the Audit Scotland report in relation to ferry procurement due to be published by the end of this month. That's currently the published or the schedule for the publication of that report. So I think we will have the best and most current and the fullest information available to the committee to reply to this petition if we come back to it shortly. We will have a more informed position if we have the benefit of the Audit Scotland report and the benefit of an agreed work programme established by the committee. Are members agreed? Agreed. Thank you very much. That means that we have dealt with the three petitions, and we will thank again the petitioners for raising these issues with the Scottish Parliament. I now close the public part of this meeting. Thank you.